Want to look at creating invention disclosures. So the first thing, if you really want to go down the patent path, is you have to look at those invention disclosures. And one thing has to do with creating a strategy. When do we want to create invention disclosure? There's really no immediate issue of when you do it. You just need to do it well before you intend to sell. When you feel like you have enough of an idea that's fleshed out enough and tested enough that it's time to start writing it down as to how that invention needs to look and what are some of the limitations you have. What's the application area, the application type? What's the scope of the application? Are you working in the medical space? Are you working in the automotive space? Or is this an aerospace application? Is this for computing or IT? All those types of things are different scopes of application. So there could be somebody developing something that's very similar in a different industry entirely, and you might be able to do something in the parallel in a different industry. Review different prior art. Look at patent searches. We're going to talk a little more about that. Public domain products, tech and trade publications, anything you can see. If you find a lot of ideas where people have already done it, it's going to be a little bit more of a challenge for you to make an invention disclosure on something that's unique and unique to what you're doing. Then we'll talk about creating a claim hierarchy outline. So these are the different components of the patent. When you're describing the pieces, how would you do that? You want to identify the unique components. What are their characteristics? What are their subcomponents? That's a very detailed component area. We'll talk more about that and when you want to entertain using an attorney rather than trying to take that on yourself. Write a description of your invention. So you got to have a title. You got to have the list of inventors who all was inventing it. Now, when you write a list of inventors, inventors cannot be companies. They cannot be LLCs. They cannot be corporations. Inventors and patents are only awarded to people, not entities. That's very important. Now, what those people do with it depends upon where they are assigning ownership to their intellectual property. Now, they could keep it personally, and then they pay for everything personally. However, oftentimes, if you work for a company, they're going to ask you to assign the intellectual property you make for them to them. So you will assign to the company you work for, just like ASU has with the research professors. Research professors have to assign their inventions to ASU if they're using university property, a significant amount of university property, and their labs and those types of things. Same with graduate students. So graduate students have to do that as well. Undergrads are a little bit unique. Undergrads can actually have things where they work through companies and outside, as well as like different consulting. But it has to be a clear delineation. So field of the invention, what area, again, this has to do with industry and what is the common fields that you would categorize this under. Background of the invention, this gives a little bit of idea of how did this invention come about, what problem are you solving, those types of things. A brief description of drawings. Now, if it's something that's physical, you want to be able to have drawings, and you need to be very articulate and specific about those drawings. A detailed description of the invention, that needs to be there as too. Then we have to refine and write different claims. Once we have those claims, now on the refining and writing the claims, if you've never done this before, don't do this yourself. I would highly recommend that you have a legal representation to write claims, because if you get it wrong, it's really costly to try to figure out how to get it right. And if you're kind of shooting in the dark first time around, better to pay a professional to help you get the claims clear and have those done correctly. If you're really adept at this and you've done this many times, maybe you can start entertaining that idea. But your invention disclosure, you can kind of get to where you write everything but the claims and then have an attorney help you from there on. You can also apply for the patents then. We'll talk about this more as we go on in this discussion. So, first phase, before you even go to a full patent, you can look at maybe a provisional patent. A provisional patent is basically kind of sticking your head up and saying, you know what, we're thinking about filing a patent and we're going to start down this process. The advantage of doing this is it gives you time. It also saves you money. So there's two real big advantages there. So the first piece, by giving you time, it allows you then to refine and develop your product more than what you initially had. And it gives you a little bit of time to then flesh out what that is. Now, what is in a provisional patent? That's the invention disclosure, requires a meaningful description of the invention. This is based upon the type of application that you're doing. You'll want to follow a writing convention and model. So I've got a model in here for you to follow. We'll talk about that. Draw numbered labeled pictures. These have to be professional style pictures. Now, in the old days, a lot of people even still will hand draw things like this. Only if you're a really good artist would I recommend doing this. Or have somebody that you can hire, and there's lots of people online that you can hire to do drawings for you that are labeled drawings. And you can even use 3D drawing software that can help you do this. Something like SolidWorks has the ability to take those drawings, and then you can convert them into black and whites for patents. So physical items absolutely requires a picture. I would highly recommend using it in some form of 3D modeling software that you can then convert into 2D drawings for black and whites, because that's still, for whatever reason, that's still the standard. They want black and white drawings. I think it's kind of silly. I think it would be nice to have three-dimensional drawings and color drawings, but they don't still want to do that. Protects invention for a year. So this gives you basically a filing date. So it's become first to file, not first to invent, which actually clears up a lot of issues that they've had. In the past, the first to invent, then everybody would have to go through the court system to figure out, okay, who had it on their lab books first? And are they lying, or did they erase things, or did they do it in pencil, not pen, so they could have changed it? So that became a whole problem. So what they started doing is it's the first to protect the invention. So this gives you first to file if you can get it provisional filed before a competitor, somebody else. And you want to make sure it's filed before public disclosure, which means, are you presenting it publicly? Are you marketing it? Are you crowdfunding it? That's one that some people miss. If you're crowdfunding it, you're kind of making it public. So you want to make sure that you have protected it, at least with a provisional patent, before, or I repeat, before you do crowdfunding. So that's critical. It's fast and cheap. It's much faster to go through this first. You can file for hundreds of dollars with the United States Patent and Trademark Office. That's what USPTO stands for, directly. If you use an attorney, you can still do that too, but be prepared to be between $1,500 to $2,000 to do that straight up. But you can do it for like a tenth of that personally. Nothing happens at the USPTO. Now, that's not entirely true, but what it is, remember, it's a filing date. It doesn't mean they're doing anything with it. It just means that it's been filed with them. So you've at least secured that date. That's really what it gets you, that time. It gives you time to work the problem. It also gives you time to make sure that your customers actually want it before you develop and spend a whole bunch of money on patents. So the other thing I highly recommend is pay a little bit more, if you can, to be in what they call it, quote unquote, stealth mode. What that is if you file and you don't go in stealth mode, it actually publicizes it through the patent office. And you'll get trolls that'll go through the patents, and then they'll try to find patents that are not fully filed, but are publicly displayed, and then they'll try to work their way around that patent, or try to say it's violating some other patent. And some trolls are attorneys trying to figure out that, hey, you're infringing on somebody else. They'll try to get that company to go after you and say, hey, you can't do this, so that they get paid for that. Others are just trying to patent around other things that they find. So to avoid that altogether, pay a little more, be in stealth mode so nobody can see it until you're actually ready for them to. What you failed to disclose may not be protected. So if there's a little unique piece or unique tech or something that you're doing that's different than everybody else, you want to make sure that you include that. Otherwise, there's going to be no protection for that component. Again, seek legal advice for this before filing full patent and get those claims correct. The claims are what happens in the courts when they start debating and determining what's protected, what's not protected, what may be infringing, what's not infringing. That's where the courts get involved on patent prosecution and protection. So those claims have to be correct, and you want to make sure that they've had several eyes on it. Also considering rolling provisionals. This is a technique if funding is pretty low. So this is really usually just for a startup when you're really kind of in a pickle and you're still getting funding and you're still building other components, still getting your teams together. Now, what that means is you could file a provisional and you're about to run out, but you're still doing research or you're still building prototypes, trying to get it to at least where you have not just a minimally viable product, but something that people will buy, getting to be ready for production. Sometimes you can do a rolling file where you file again because you're about to run out on your last file. The risk is if it's a red ocean space, so to speak, or a highly competitive space, there's probably others in there about ready to file something that might compete with what you're doing. That's really risky. If it's very blue ocean and there's not very many competitors or only a couple of competitors, maybe they're not looking at that right now. Maybe they're selling other items. Or if it's a brand new space, you might have a little bit more time on your side where you could just basically set a new date where you're starting. So that's a technique that you can use, but you do run a risk that somebody else has filed in the interim. So be careful of that.